Hello, and thank you for taking the time to join me today. In this video, I will discuss two subject matters. Firstly, the Kiev Pechersk Lavra, or in English, the Monastery of the Caves. The expulsions and arrests of monks at the Monastery of the Caves in Kiev by the Ukrainian government is part of an ongoing and systematic campaign by the Ukrainian government to annihilate Russian culture in Ukraine, a campaign which has the full blessing of the West. And it is at this point that I should say that such a campaign constitutes cultural genocide. Ever since the Western engineered coup in Kiev in February of 2014, which saw a violently anti-Russian government come to power, the Ukrainian state has attempted to eradicate all traces of Russian culture in Ukraine by, for instance, imposing severe restrictions on the use of the Russian language, something which is absurdity at its most absurd, given that, firstly, the overwhelming majority of the Ukrainian population converse on a day-to-day basis in the Russian language, and secondly, more often than not, when Ukrainian government ministers give interviews, they inadvertently stop speaking in a Ukrainian dialect and instead speak in pure Russian. Nonetheless, by the Ukrainian government attempting to destroy Russian culture in Ukraine, the Ukrainian government is attempting to say to the world that the Ukrainian population is ethnically and culturally distinct from that of the Russian population. Now, anyone who has even an ounce of knowledge about Ukraine and Russian history in general will know that that is a grotesque lie. Indeed, anyone who says that Ukraine is culturally and ethnically distinct from Russia is either an ignorant fool or a useful idiot. Now, returning to the appalling situation at the Monastery of the Caves in Kiev, by the Ukrainian government expelling and arresting monks at the aforementioned monastery, this is a way of the Ukrainian government striking at the very heart of Russian culture in Ukraine, which is the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. The Moscow Patriarchate is by far the largest church in Ukraine. At the very least, 50% of the Ukrainian population are adherents to the Moscow Patriarchate, and as much as 60 to 65% belong to the Moscow Patriarchate. The rest of the Ukrainian population either belong to the Orthodox Church of Ukraine, previously the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Kiev Patriarchate, or they belong to the Catholic Church. The Moscow Patriarchate is dominant in eastern Ukraine, northeastern Ukraine, southern Ukraine, and much of central Ukraine, which includes the Kiev Oblast, the Kirovgrad Oblast, the Zhytomyr Oblast, and the Vinnytsia Oblast. Where the Orthodox Church of Ukraine and the Catholic Church is dominant is in the westernmost part of Ukraine, oblasts such as Lvov, Ternopil, and Ivano-Frankivsk. You may wonder as to why the Catholic Church has a heavy presence in the westernmost part of Ukraine. Well, that is on account of how this region was for centuries ruled by the Poles and the Austrians. But returning to the situation at the Monastery of the Caves, the Ukrainian government is attempting to destroy completely Russian culture in Ukraine by decimating the Moscow Patriarchate. That is why, in the last year, Zelensky and the rest of the Ukrainian government have taken diabolical steps to reduce the influence of the Moscow Patriarchate in Ukraine, to vilify the Moscow Patriarchate in Ukraine. And such steps are essentially an attack on a substantial part of the Ukrainian population. Because, as I said moments ago, the majority of the Ukrainian population belong to the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate. Thus, the Ukrainian government is waging a war, a cultural war, against a substantial part of the Ukrainian population. One final note on this matter. I am aware that there are various institutes, think tanks, and polling companies in Ukraine which say that the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of the Moscow Patriarchate has a very small number of Ukrainians which belong to it. Well, that is absurdity at its absurd, and at the same time, it is a horrific lie. Those institutes, think tanks, and polling companies are neither free nor independent. They are controlled by the Ukrainian government, and they are used by the Ukrainian government to paint a picture to the outside world that Ukraine is ethnically and culturally distinct from that of Russia. The so-called findings of these institutes, think tanks, and polling companies should be utterly ignored and disregarded because, as I said, they are neither free nor independent. They are weapons of the Ukrainian government. No different to how think tanks, institutes, and polling companies in Western countries, such as in America and Britain, are controlled by the British establishment or the American establishment. Now, the next matter I would like to comment upon is Africa and India in the context of the war in Ukraine. Western governments are irate at how governments across the whole of Africa and at the Indian government, for not having taken the side of the West against Russia, for not having placed sanctions on the Russian government, and for not having sent military weapons to the Ukrainian government. Indeed, we are hearing from Indian officials and Indian journalists and African officials and African journalists that the Western ruling elites are attempting to intimidate and bully African countries and India into siding with the West against Russia. Well, there are a number of observations I will make about that. First of all, that the West is doing that to countries in Africa and to India demonstrates the West's utter contempt for the very concept of a country's independence and sovereignty, which, of course, is at the core of international law and the United Nations Charter. It is up to countries in Africa and the Indian government to decide whether they take the stance of the West or if they maintain their relationship with Russia. The West has no right whatsoever, moral, political, or legal, to attempt to intimidate governments in Africa and the Indian government into siding with it against Russia. The West is not God. The West should learn to respect the concept of a country's independence and sovereignty. And secondly, what it demonstrates is that the Western ruling elites maintain a diabolical and condescending attitude to Africa and India, two places which, of course, they want ruled. We know that during colonial times, British, French, Belgian, and German colonial times in Africa, North Africa, and sub-Saharan Africa, and in India, these Western imperialists committed various genocides and plundered Africa and plundered India. For example, the British state committed genocide in Kenya, and they committed genocide in India. If we take the latter, India, over a 40-year period, the British ruling elite, the British state, killed 165 million Indians, which undoubtedly constitutes the largest act of genocide the world has ever known. Now, compare the murderous behavior of the West in Africa and in India to that of the behavior of Russia in Africa and in India. Ask any African or ask any Indian, and they will say that Russia has only ever been a friend to countries across Africa and a friend to India. When the Western imperialists left Africa and India, the Russians, or as it was then, the Soviet Union, played an important role in developing an economic infrastructure in Africa and in India. The Soviet government constructed bridges, reservoirs, dams, and motorways in various African countries and in India. So that is why we are hearing now numerous African leaders and foreign ministers and senior Indian officials castigate the West for demanding that they regard Russia as an enemy. As one African politician recently said, the West is telling us to regard Russia, which has only ever been a friend to us, as an enemy. This is the same West that murdered, raped, plundered, and humiliated Africa as a whole. And yet the West has the audacity to call upon Africa as a whole to regard a friend, Russia, as an enemy. The behavior of the West in Africa and in India is truly atrocious. It is reprehensible. It is unforgivable. But of course, the West is desperate. Despite Western proclamations that the world is united against Russia, the West knows that this is nothing but a lie. Out of 193 countries in the world, only 30 or so have imposed sanctions on Russia and have sent weapons to the Ukrainian government, which means that the vast majority of the world does not support the West's stance on Russia. So, again, in regard to Africa and India, the governments in Africa and the Indian government have every legal, moral, and political right to not side with the stance of the West in its confrontation with Russia. Remember again and again that the West committed genocides in Africa, and the British were one of those countries which committed genocide in Africa, and the British state committed genocide in India. Any African, any Indian will tell you that Russia is not an enemy of Africa or India. Russia has only ever been a friend of Africa and India. Indeed, another example of that is what the South African foreign minister once said. Russia was always a friend to the people of South Africa during the period of apartheid to the present day. So, the West, in attempting to intimidate and bully Africa and India into siding with it over Russia, demonstrates firstly its contempt for international law and the United Nations Charter, and it demonstrates that it regards the people of Africa and the people in India as not second-class citizens, not third-class citizens, but as semi-humans. Their mindset towards people in Africa and the people of India has not changed since colonial times. The British state, for example, has never recognized that it committed genocide in India, has never recognized that it committed genocide in Kenya. Indeed, the British state has committed the most genocides in history. The British state committed genocide in Ireland. They committed genocide against the Native Americans. They committed genocide against the Aborigines. They committed genocide against the Maoris. And they committed genocide in Africa. Yet they do not recognize this. And they do not even express any regret for the millions upon millions upon millions of people whom they conquered and who died under their brutal rule. Thank you, as always, for having taken the time to listen to my analysis and my observations, and I hope very soon to produce a new video.